Good morning, and welcome to worship here at Trinity-St. Andrews. Nice to see who the early birds are on a day like this. So special welcome to everyone who made it out this morning and those who are tuning in later online. It's good to have you as well. We have a number of announcements for you. Leslie is going to be doing one, and then John will be following up. And Sandra has one as well.
Good morning. Just to draw your attention to the insert in your bulletin, and for those watching from home, Barb Symington is moving to the Peterborough area at the end of the month, and we would like to honor her with a farewell party and to thank her for her many hours, years of hard work for TSA. So next Sunday, the 17th, we will have a party in Stewart Hall following the service. Please come and bid her for farewell. Thank you.
Hi, as a follow-up to last week, I mentioned the people from Nigeria who were coming to Renfrew, the four that were here last week, as well as about 15 more, I believe, that are still coming. In addition to the place to stay, they're also potentially looking for furniture and just basic dishes and linens and that kind of thing. They don't need a whole lot, but they do need something. So if anybody has any of that, please contact me and I can forward that on. So.
You're okay. Yeah, we wondered whether that was going to be okay. All right. Other announcements. You'll see on the orange sheet, yellow, whatever this color is, goldenrod. Is this goldenrod? Yes. Okay, good. Easter lilies are coming. Easter is coming up at the end of the month, and we're looking for donations, and the information is there. The beautiful flowers you see beside me are placed by John and Marilyn Naismith in loving memory of their parents, and we give them thanks for that. You can see this is a busy week in the life of our church. One of our big ministries is that the pastoral care team and I go to the long-term care homes here in Renfrew. And so this afternoon, we're at Bonacher Manor. And then on Tuesday, we're at Groves Park. And then the following Tuesday, we're at Quail Creek. And we do this about every month, taking worship to members of our congregation, but also to people from the community who've been part of their churches for decades and are now no longer able to be out. And so we'd ask for your parents' support, because this is an important ministry. It's not an easy one, but we feel it's a very important one that we keep contact with those people who've been part of us for so long. You can see that our ukulele group is Monday night at 7, and the men's breakfast is Wednesday morning at 9 a.m. And I think that's it for announcements. Was there anyone else that needed? I think we're good. So, all right, so then let us prepare our hearts for worship as we light our Christ candle for today. As we journey towards the darkness of the cross, we light a candle to remind us of the light that cannot be put out. May this light remind us that we're not alone in all the changing scenes of life, for we do not make the journey from death to resurrection alone, for God is with us. As we gather for worship this day, we proclaim the good news that God so loves Renfrew County that God gives us his only child, Jesus Christ, so that any human being of any background who believes in the way of Christ will share in this gift of eternal joy and life in abundance. So come, let us celebrate this gift as we lift our hearts and voices to praise our God. Please join in singing our opening hymn. It's number 220 in your Voices United hymn book, number 220, Praise to the Lord, the Almighty. Let us join our hearts in a word of prayer. Loving God, we know you are the source of all life, and you share this wondrous gift with us, and you invite us to bless others by the gifts that we share, and you send us prophets to remind us of these gifts and how we can use them for your purposes of healing, hope, comfort, peace, and love. Forgive us when we get so caught up in the details of living that we neglect this gift and refuse to help others. May the light of your love shine brightly in each of us, and may we learn to shine all the more brightly when we choose to shine together. Heal us and forgive us, we pray. Give us hearts for joyful caring and sharing as we seek to follow the way of Jesus this day and every day. Amen. Okay, I'd call upon Jane Lambert, who will read us the scriptures for this morning.
Our first scripture this morning is from Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 to 10. As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins, in which you used to live when you followed the ways of this world and of the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. All of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our flesh, and following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature deserving of wrath. But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages he might show the incomparable riches of his grace, expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. For it is by grace you've been saved through faith, and this is not from ourselves, but it is a gift of God. Not by works, so that no one can boast, for we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good, works which God prepared in advance for us to do. And then the responsive psalm reading this morning is 107, parts 1 and 2, and page 831. O give thanks, for God is gracious. God's steadfast love endures forever. Let the redeemed of God say so, those redeemed from trouble, whom God gathered in from the lands. From the east and the west, from the north and the south, some lost their way in desert wastes, finding no place to settle. Hungry and thirsty, their soul fainted within them. Then they cried to you, God, in their trouble. You rescued them from their distress. You led them by a straight path till they reached a place to settle. Let them thank you, O God, for your steadfast love, for the wonders you do for us. For you satisfy the thirsty and fill the hungry with good things. Some suffered because of their sinful ways, afflicted on account of their wrongdoing. They loathed every kind of food. They came close to the gates of death. Then they cried to you, God, in their trouble. You rescued them from their distress. You gave the word and healed them. You saved them from the grave. Let them thank you, God, for your steadfast love, for the wonders you do for us. Let them offer the sacrifice of thanksgiving and tell of your deeds with shouts of joy.
Oh, give thanks to God for steadfast love.
And the gospel this morning, please stand if you are able. And it's John 3, verses 14 to 21. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes in him may have eternal life in him. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already, because they've not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. This is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but people love darkness instead of light because their deeds were evil. And everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear that their deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light, so it may be seen plainly that they have seen plainly that what they have done has been done in the sight of God. Please be seated. Oops.
Thank you, Jane. Our next hymn is 147 in your Voices United hymn book. What wondrous love is this? 147. Thank you. The story of Jesus' life, his death and resurrection, is without a doubt one of the greatest stories ever told. It's a story full of dramatic intrigue, shocking revelations, and heroic self-sacrifice. At the same time, it's also a story of ordinary people who have these moving encounters with God when they run into Jesus. And it is these small personal encounters with Jesus which demonstrate how our lives can be changed when we choose to meet God in our world today. This morning, Jane read to you one of the more famous passages of Scripture, the born again passage. And that passage actually happens as part of a conversation, because Jesus is meeting Nicodemus, one of the leaders of the Jewish people in Jerusalem. And out of that conversation, that's when those words are spoken. And Nicodemus, well, yes, it is a life-changing experience, but it's a rather unlikely candidate for such an experience. Because at first glance, we might wonder, why would Nicodemus, this person who's high and mighty in the religious establishment, why would they want to meet with Jesus at all? By the standards of his day, he was a holy man, a righteous man. Nicodemus was a well-respected member of his community. And his approach for religion was very clear. It gave him a checklist of behavior for good living every day. And if you met Nicodemus, he would size you up very quickly, because he would measure a person's righteousness by how many times a day did you say your prayers in public. And he would judge people by how strictly they followed those cleanliness laws and the food laws laid out in the Bible. He knew how to measure right from wrong. But in the face of such certainty in his religious life, Nicodemus is confronted with the problem of Jesus. You see, Nicodemus believed God is in the temple, that God lived in the temple. And only once a year could the most educated and holy of the priests enter into the actual presence of God. Everyone else was just sort of sitting outside waiting for that to happen. But here in Jesus is a simple, uneducated country preacher who talks about knowing God on a personal basis, who finds God outside of the temple in the most unlikely of places, like in fishing boats, in the lives of shepherds, farmers, and housewives. Here's a man who loves people more than the rules, so he dares to heal the sick on the Sabbath day. What a travesty, what a way to disregard the rules. And Jesus even has the nerve to say that he has authority to forgive people's sins. Only God could do that. So the actions of Jesus challenge every single belief that Nicodemus holds to be sacred. And what's worse is the way the crowds are going over to Jesus in a big way. Nicodemus wonders how God could be doing something so different and so amazing with a peasant nobody from Galilee, of all places. I mean, everybody knows nothing good comes out of Galilee. Yet part of Nicodemus senses that Jesus can't be doing all this on his own. Truly, maybe God's Spirit is working with this carpenter from Nazareth in order to work such miracles? He's so perplexed, Nicodemus figures out he has to go and see Jesus for himself. But he knows such a trip can't be made publicly, because that would just give official approval to what Jesus is doing. So he knows it has to be done secretly. So Nicodemus goes at night, after all the crowds have gone home, after the disciples have gone to bed and the spies have stopped snooping around. Nicodemus goes at night with the intention of testing Jesus. Is God really with him or not? And when they finally do meet, the tables are turned. And it is Jesus who does the testing, and it's Nicodemus who ends up being changed. And it's a very unlikely kind of meeting. Because back in those days, when a student would go to study under a great rabbi, or if you went to talk to a great rabbi, it would often take a long time before you got to know sort of the heart of what that teacher was about. It would often take years before a student would even learn all of the great truths of Scripture and all the secrets of the faith. Nicodemus is just getting the conversation with Jesus starting, and he's barely spoken his words of greeting, and Jesus just starts telling him everything. Jesus reveals the truth of his teaching. It's not a closely guarded secret, which only the select few get to know. With this Jesus, his teaching is a free gift that everyone is free to experience and then share with everyone else that they meet. And it is then that Nicodemus is told he must be born from above if he's to be a part of the kingdom of God. It's from that passage that we get the very famous phrase, you must be born again. But it's a hard phrase for a straight-thinking man like Nicodemus to really get. At first, he thinks Jesus is talking about a physical rebirth, and he says, well, that can't happen. Because he knows very well what a religious and good life should look like. But his failure to understand Jesus' message reveals his lack of spiritual feelings. Without that spiritual center, the religious life is incomplete. That's because there's a real difference between being spiritual and being religious. A spiritual person is someone who's aware that there is something more to this life, and that's a personal feeling that gives them a sense of peace, wonder, and purpose. A religious person is someone who shares in a common set of beliefs and practices about that spiritual dimension. One way to understand the difference between spirituality and religion is to imagine tonight that you're out looking at the night sky. And how do you get close to it all? Well, spirituality is the telescope that helps us experience the wonder of seeing those stars and planets up close. Organized religion is the collected experiences of generations of astronomers who have figured out how to measure the stars. We who are religious fall down when we think we know how to measure the universe, but we no longer feel that sense of awe and wonder when we look up at the night sky. Our religion grows stale as a result when we think that following the rules is all that's required of us. Our religion gets arrogant when we think we have a monopoly on being good and no one else is good. And we fall short of our beliefs when we fail to act in a loving way towards others, especially those outside of our tradition. And we'd all fall down when we confess to be trusting a God, but our actions reveal our own self-centered motives. You see, our Christian beliefs are meant to challenge us, to stretch us. They're aspirational targets. And we trip ourselves up when we forget that we're not perfect in all this, yet we condemn those around us when they're not perfect. And so it's unfortunate that for many people, their experience of Christianity looks a lot like the faith of Nicodemus. For them, religion can look like a lot of rules for moral behavior, yet it suffers from a real shortage of forgiveness, love, or compassion. When that happens, religion can get in the way of a healthy spirituality. When that happens, many people quickly come to the conclusion that they don't need the God of religion in order to live their life well. Now, there are many other reasons why people today don't feel they need God. We have filled our lives with very many shiny things. We live very comfortable lives. We spend our days consuming and wanting more things. We fill our lives with diversions like shopping, travel, and technology, which are all very pleasant and good. But then we wonder why we've not experienced God's love. Well, I believe God does try to shine that divine love on us every single day. But often we are so distracted that we don't even notice it when it happens. I believe every person here has had at least one profound experience of God in their lives in the last month. Did you recognize it? Did you know when that moment happened? Or are you going, not quite sure? I'm sure it happened, though. It was an experience that was powerful enough to move mountains. It was powerful enough to cause a religious reawakening if you were open to that moment. And if you needed it, that moment of simple joy, it was there. So how many of you recognized it? Anyone? No? I know it happened. These moments happen all the time if we're willing to risk being open to God and the moment. When did it happen? Well, let me give you some examples. It was the moment when you solved a problem and the answer just came. It came when you remembered someone and you called them out of the blue and you made their day. It happened when someone hugged you. It happened in one of those thin places and it made the hairs in the back of your neck stand up. It might have been when you were making love to your partner. It might have happened when you were listening to a familiar song. You know the one that you used to sing when you were young? And when you hear that song, you're taken right back there, back in time. That can be a holy moment. It happened in that strange and magical moment when you drove through the fog and saw the world in a different way. Now, you may think the minister is being crazy by suggesting that God could be present in such everyday moments like those. But that's exactly what Jesus is trying to tell us here. The Gospels are full of stories of how we can find the divine in the everyday experiences of everyday people like you and me. And we see that, we do a Bible study here every week on Wednesday mornings, and we get to look at these stories, and we keep seeing these stories of people being changed by God. But the funny thing with our Wednesday Bible study is, we begin the Bible study not with prayer, not with something formal. We start by saying, where did you see God at work in your life this week? Where did you see God at work in your life this week? And when I first started this in Bible study, the people were sort of going, ooh, this is a little bit uncomfortable. But then they started getting used to the idea and thinking in those terms. And next thing you know, they started looking for those moments and they started seeing it everywhere. And I remember one week, one of the members of the Bible study came in and saying, I've been waiting all week to tell you about this most amazing thing that happened to me this week. And it's just like, yeah, we all saw it. These days with that Bible study, it's supposed to be an hour long. The first 20 minutes is often just spent listening to each other tell the story of, where did you see God at work in your life this week? And that whole Bible study group, it's been changed by that. When one of the group is going through a hard time, they're there for each other. They listen to each other and care for each other. They've learned how to comfortably talk about their faith without sounding like you're crazy. And it's not a big and flashy moment. We're not testifying and doing all kinds of crazy stuff. It's just, honestly, this is what happened, and God was part of it. And so you can really feel the Spirit at play in the room when we gather. And it is really something beautiful to experience. It's one of the highlights of the week, just hearing everyone share what is that moment. And Jesus offered that same moment, that same gift of the Holy Spirit to Nicodemus. And his life, well, it was changed. He did accept the idea of being born anew. And Nicodemus became a follower of Jesus. And when Jesus dies, Nicodemus is one of the people who plays an important part in taking care of Jesus' body after he dies. And today we're celebrating that Jesus is offering that same gift of salvation to each of us. He wants each of us to be born anew. He invites us to be born again into life with the full power of the Holy Spirit. To live by the Spirit is to be open to these small moments when God is present in your life. It's to regain that sense of wonder when you look up at the night sky and you just go, oh, wow, there's just so much. Life goes so much beyond us. It's to see the world with fresh eyes, the way a little child looks at the world, full of wonder. Because we all know a religious life is much more than following a set of rules for good behavior. It's to wake up each morning full of excitement, knowing that God is going to be part of everything you face today. I want to close by rereading that very famous passage from John's Gospel. I'm going to use a contemporary translation that's called The Message. This is how much God loves the world. He gave his Son, his one and only Son. And this is why, so that no one would be destroyed. By believing in him, anyone can have a whole and lasting life. God didn't go to all the trouble of sending his Son merely to point an accusing finger, telling the world how bad it is. He came to help. He came to help and put the world right again. Let us pray. Loving God, may we see these moments when you're near us. Free our hands so we might sense those moments when you do touch us. Make us alive to your presence so our lives might be transformed as we live in you. May we be open to Jesus Christ making a difference in our lives, forgiving our sins, healing our wounds, so we might share in the Spirit of life itself. Amen.
My Jesus.
Can I get an amen? Amen. Thank you. That was beautiful. Very beautiful. We give thanks for everyone who shares their gifts and continues to support our church and our many ministries. Your gifts of support and encouragement do mean a lot to us. You can get more information about making a donation to the church by contacting our church office or by visiting our website. For the gifts you share, for the people you bless by your serving and giving as a disciple of Jesus, we give our humble thanks. I invite you to sing our offering song. It's the chorus of number 79 in the More Voices book, Spirit, Open Our Hearts, the chorus only.
Spirit, open my heart to the joy and pain of living. As you love me, I love in receiving and in giving. Spirit, open my heart.
Almighty God, you made us who we are. So we offer all of ourselves to you. Take our talents, our energy, and our joy, and use us to share your gift of love. And please also use our mistakes and our pain, that we might help bring your healing to this broken world. May the gifts we offer before you today help to spread your gift of peace in this world. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Our next hymn is in your More Voices book, number 46, Bless the Lord, O My Soul, Bless the Lord, 46. Let us join our hearts in a word of prayer. Loving God, we're thankful that you do keep reaching out to us, that you find new ways to connect with us and open up our hearts to a sense of wonder, joy, and peace. As we follow the way of Jesus, may that joy and peace be at the heart of all we do. And even as we keep commandments, we keep them in that spirit of love and grace and forgiveness. Because we know none of us are perfect. We all struggle to follow the way of Jesus, but it lifts us up to a better way of living. And may we have grace with those who, others who struggle. May we be encouragers and not complainers. Instead of offering the pointed finger of shame, may we offer the open hand of friendship and help. Give us courage for the living of these days, dear Lord, that we may follow your way in peace and be a blessing to your world. For we know there are many places in this world, dear Lord, where there is trouble. We think of the pain and suffering happening in Gaza that seems to serve no point and has no end and no way to be resolved. But we know that peace is going to be the only way to end that conflict well. May there be courage on both sides to sit down and work through the differences, to give up what is needed, to get what is required, so there may be a good life for all people, both Palestinians, Christians, and Jews. And we pray for other places in this world where there is conflict, in Sudan, in Ukraine, and in so many other parts of the world, far too many for us to count. For the walls that divide, for the hatred that splits people apart, we pray that there will be reconciliation, that there will be justice, and that people will be free to enjoy their homes in peace once more. But we know that only words backed up by actions, can end wars. Bullets and bombs will never end a war, it just prolongs the suffering. May we be people who call for peace in every moment, no matter how hard that word is to enact in reality. We pray for peace in our own community, dear Lord. There's lots of forces that seem to drive us apart, make us question each other, make us snipe and complain when we don't like what our leaders are doing. And it also causes us to lose trust and faith in one another, lose faith and trust in our institutions and our way of being as a community, as a country, as a planet. Help us to seek the middle way, the way of reconciliation, the way of forgiveness, the way of healing as a hopeful way forward for this world. So give us the courage for living these days, dear Lord. As we follow the way of Jesus, may we be born anew. May we be filled with wonder, peace, and joy. So guide us and bless us for the living of these days. We ask all this using those words that Jesus taught us to say together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Just a reminder that following the service, you're invited downstairs to Stuart Hall, which is immediately below us, and there'll be coffee, tea, and cookies, and fellowship, and we do hope you join us as we gather there afterwards. We go out singing a great hymn of the faith, I, the Lord of Sea and Sky. It's number 509 in your Voices United book, I, the Lord of Sea and Sky, 509. we live in often feels so dark, God continues to love this crazy old world. So may the God who makes all things new send you back into this world with your creative energies refreshed. May Christ, the eternal light, illuminate your darkest moments so you too might shine. And may the Holy Spirit of steadfast love guide you every step of the way, this day and forevermore. Go now in peace. Amen.